Since the 4th century, the Church, recognizing the need to prepare and celebrate the birth of Christ, has set aside the 4 weeks prior to Christmas as a time of preparation. This season, called Advent, is meant to prepare us as we celebrate the birth of the One who came some 2,000 years ago, who comes today, and who will come again.
This season of Advent begins and calls us to prepare ourselves to the world for the celebration of the Incarnation, the presence within history of Jesus the Christ. It is the acknowledgement that Jesus is Emmanuel, God with us. It is in preparing ourselves as the Church that we proclaim to the world at large the good news of Jesus Christ. We tell the story of his birth, we tell of the people who participated in this timeless event, and we tell of the great spiritual meaning of God's love to all who might listen.
Advent is a time for symbols, which are often able to say more than words can say. Symbols are tangible expressions of our faith. They help us express beyond words the deepest meaning of our faith. The symbols which we will use this morning have special significance as they become a part of the preparations of this people in this place. Throughout the Advent season, these symbols will call us to remember and to respond to God and to one another.
Imagine an ancient soul. She knows the creation. She lives in touch with all the Creator has made. There's an inner truth that tells her that there is someone beautiful behind all the beauty she knows in the world. So when she carries a bough of cedar into her dwelling place and places it on the hearth, it isn't simply a decoration, but rather an act of reverence for creation and a longing for the Creator. She knew, even without a sacred story, that the divine image was in all creation.
And now, imagine an early Christian, centuries and centuries ago, the recipient of a sacred experience and a sacred story. He cuts a bough from a cypress tree and takes it into his house and speaks of it as bringing home Christmas. He has made his home ready for a holiday celebration by bringing creation inside to honor and worship the Creator.
Today, we will join our ancestors by bringing greenery into our church, by hanging wreaths in our sanctuary. We will enjoy them and anticipate that their beauty and symbolism will speak to us and nurture us. The bright colors will stir us. The wreaths will remind us of what is infinite and never-ending. The evergreens will point us to the eternal, with the branches always full of life. They are symbols of hope.
It is the hope of Christmas. As Isaiah foretold, a shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. From his roots, a branch will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the Spirit of counsel and of power, the Spirit of knowledge and of the reverence of God.
Poinsettias are everywhere during the Christmas season. They bloom in vivid color and all around us while other plants have lost all signs of life. Isaiah once proclaimed, "The desert and the parched land will be glad. The wilderness will rejoice and blossom like a flower. It will burst into bloom and will shout for joy." Isaiah 35:1-2. Poinsettias are the fruition of Isaiah's sermon. In the dead of winter, they come to life.
On each leaf, there is a hint of the star. We'll see it if we are looking with eyes of faith, and perhaps we even allow that star to guide us to worship the Christ child, even as Magi were guided by something mysterious. They heard stars proclaiming.
This plant blooms at Christmas in Mexico, where it's known by its native name, Flower of the Holy Night. The legend tells of a small boy who had no gift to bring to the Christ child's manger bed in the village church. As he trudged towards the church, scuffling his feet in the dust of the road, he decided that he could at least offer the holy infant the branches from a bush that grew beside the way. Quickly, he stripped off some of the branches and made his way to the church, where he reverently placed the green leaves at the manger. As he knelt there, the other children jeered and mocked his offering. Rising tearfully, he looked once more at the branches, only to find that where his tears had fallen bloomed a brilliant, star-shaped flower.
Nativity scenes provide a vivid impression of the circumstances under which Christ was born. The Gospel of Luke tells us that, while they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in clothes and placed him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn.
In France, such a scene is called a crèche, and is the chief feature of French Christmas observances. The crèche shows baby Jesus in the manger, watched over by Mary and Joseph, while nearby in the attitude of worship are the shepherds and magi of the Christmas story.
This Christmas custom is said to have originated in the church as early as the 8th century. However, it was Saint Francis of Assisi who popularized the reenactment of the birth of the child Christ as a part of the Christmas observance, when he set up a simple manger scene at the little town of Greccio in Italy in 1224.
Just 3 years before his death, Saint Francis saw some shepherds sleeping in the fields near Greccio. This gave him the inspiration for depicting the coming of the Savior in a way all could understand. So he found a cave, built a little stable in it, and covered the floor with straw. He also put a live ox and donkey nearby. Real persons took the parts of Mary and Joseph and the shepherds. Many of the peasants who lived nearby came to look at the nativity scene. For the first time, they told him that they understood the true meaning of that event in the stable in Bethlehem.
Of all the Christmas decorations, none is more cherished in our culture than the Christmas tree. In most homes, it is a place of fun and focus, of joy and memory. It is the centerpiece of the holiday celebration. The ancients held trees in great reverence, often bringing them indoors for the feast of Bacchus. In Roman times, trees were decorated with trinkets in the celebration of the pagan Yule season, the ancient sun-worshipping Teutons, and said to have decorated fir trees because they likened the sun to the spreading of blossoming of a great tree.
Because evergreens were associated with the pagans, some Christian churches forbid their use. However, those who prepared the services of Advent recalled from the words of Isaiah concerning the preparation of the holy place. The glory of Lebanon shall come to you, the cypress and the pine, to beautify the place of my sanctuary, and I will make the place of my feet glorious. And so the evergreen tree was integrated into our Christmas celebration.
There are many legends and stories connected with the tree. It is said that Martin Luther, in an attempt to describe to his wife and children the beauty of the snow-covered forest under the glittering sky, went into the garden, cut a small fir tree, and set it up in the nursery. and put some lighted candles on its branches to represent the stars.
In our church, the tree is decorated with chrismons, or Christ monograms, each being a symbol of Christ. Some use Greek letters that spell his name. Others symbolize various aspects of his character or ministry. They are stars and butterflies, crowns and crosses, symbols of all kinds. All pay honor and bring understanding to Christ. Although we worship the great I Am that is beyond naming and containing, the chrismons on our tree remind us of all the ways the divine has reached out to us and been known to us.
Christian worship has, from almost the beginning, been illuminated, enhanced, and made beautiful by the warm glow of candles. What was once a means by which to see, especially during the years of persecution and underground worship, became a way of seeing spiritually. A candle's flame makes a silent proclamation to anyone who will take the time to sit and see.
During the Christmas season, especially, candles reflect our deep and tender mood, as well as our bright hope and joy. Here in winter solstice, our candles bring something special into this room. A simple flame invites us to ponder the mystery that God has come to shine in our darkness.
This is the gospel we proclaim. In him was life, and the light that was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not overcome it. John 1:4-5.
Isaiah 9 says, "The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoiced before you as a people rejoice at the harvest, as men rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace."
This morning we light the first candle, the candle of hope that Jesus brings. The people of Israel had experienced years of oppression, hoping to someday be free of their suffering. Jesus Christ is their hope realized. The hope of Israel and our hope today has always been an assured hope, for the earthly appearance of Jesus is not the result of a creation of a new being, for Jesus is. The pre-existent Christ was with humanity from the beginning and will be with us who love him through eternity. Our hope is assured because the existence of the bearer of our hope was never in question. Jesus is the one who was, who is, and who evermore shall be, and therefore our Christian hope is secure, and always has been secure since even before the beginning of time.